Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Jack Joseph and Morton Mandel School of Applied Social Sciences and the last of our Centennial Research and Training Colloquia series for this academic year. I'm Elizabeth Tracy. I'm a professor and associate dean for research and training here at the school. As has been our tradition, we're a diverse group of people gathered here today. We have master's and doctoral students, alumni, faculty, field instructors, research staff, and associates and community practitioners and administrators. We represent the social work profession and the Mandel School quite well. A warm welcome also to the many viewers who are connecting remotely through our live streaming. I also want to recognize that Dean Gilmore is with us today, David Beagle, who's chair of the doctoral program, and Kathy Farkas and Denise Gibson, who are two of the co-chairs of the Centennial Planning Committee, and I always welcome their faces out there. Logistics, as you know, restrooms to the right in the lobby. There's a sign-up sheet for PD and CREC hours. The CEU certificates will be in the lobby when we are done. For questions, we need to use a microphone. You might remember this from previous, so I will be running to you with the microphone if you would hold your question until I get there to reach you. And for those who are connecting remotely, you can email questions to mandelschool@case.edu. Some well-deserved thank yous to Helen Menke from the doctoral program, Ina Brand, Maria Sharon, Tracy Bradnan, Nora Hennessy, Associate Dean for Institutional Advancement. All of these people have helped with this series. This colloquia is co-sponsored by the Office of Research Administration and the doctoral program at the Mandel School. And we're pleased and proud to note that all of the speakers in this series were graduates of the Mandel School. And today we're happy to have with us Dr. Kimberly Strom Gottfried, who received her MSW from Adelphi University and her PhD in 1993 from the Mandel School. She's the Smith P. Thiemann Distinguished Professor of Ethics and Professional Practice. It's one of the only chairs devoted to ethics in the country at the University of North Carolina Chapel Hill School of Social Work, where she teaches in the areas of direct practice, education, and human resource management. Her scholarly interests, as many of the doctoral students got to hear in the hour we spent with her before this talk, involve ethics, moral courage, and leadership. She's active in training, consultation, and research on these topics. She's written over 60 articles, monographs, and chapters on ethics and practice. She's the author of Straight Talk About Professional Ethics and The Ethics of Practice with Minors, and will be the author of a forthcoming book called Cultivating Courage. Her workshop today is titled Ethical Research Beyond Human Subjects, Beyond Fraud and the IRB. Please join me now in welcoming Dr. Kim Strom Gottfried.
Well, as Thomas Wolfe, native son of North Carolina, said, you can't go home again, and because home changes. But it's also nice when you do go home to know that there are familiar people and places, even though you've redecorated the building that I came to know so well. And I just really am grateful to be back. I'm grateful to Betsy and the team for all of the logistics, both in getting this, the timing of this organized, and also accommodating changes in my schedule, and also just for the warm welcome. It's really, really nice to be back here. And I will also say a bit intimidating because the people who were formative to my journey as a scholar and as an educator are in this room. And so that just notches those stakes up just a little higher. So I'm grateful to be here and really want to make this time as useful to you as possible. I know wherever you've come from, whatever background, whatever you're not doing now, your work isn't stopping just because you're here, that emails and phone calls and tasks are piling up. And I really want to make my pledge to you to make this time as useful to you as possible. It's rare that we get a chance to kind of come together with bright people and talk about the difficult aspects of our work. And one of the aspects that we'll talk about today is the cast of the intersection of ethics and research. And so you have my pledge to make this a time as useful as possible to you to create the opportunity for conversation as much as our technology and our distance will allow, to begin to think through these questions and also perhaps leave with more questions than those which we came with. But that's part of the challenge of ethics. And so, and I want to say happy birthday, MSAS. I calculated that I was here for the 75th birthday, which makes me feel, I should have gone and looked and seen what kind of swag I had from the 75th. But I'm really proud of my education here and grateful for it, and so it's wonderful to be here. I always put my contact information on my slides because my work is made better by your work. The situations that you encounter as clinicians, as teachers, as community members, as researchers, those help me put my money where my mouth is as a scholar to try to get a phone call and think through a vexing ethical situation. And I had someone who was dealing with fellow professionals' behavior during a custody evaluation who called me yesterday to kind of talk through what her responsibilities were as a fellow social worker. So I feel honored to have the chair, and I have to integrity requires me to say it's the first at any school of social work in the country. There are others, but it compels me to make myself available to folks for these conversations because the complexities of our work give me the opportunity to kind of think through what it is that people need and what it is that I have to offer. So you know where to find me, and I certainly hope that you will as we go forward. It's always a little risky to get me to talk about ethics because I have a lot of interests in ethics. So we have a clear script today, but we also have a lot of opportunity for conversation and for movement. So my plan for the day, let me talk about this topic for a second. It started, my particular interest in this started or came together 2 years ago. I presented at the European Social Work Research Conference in Bolzano, Italy, with a colleague from Italy, another from Slovenia, one from Germany, and myself. And we all had different takes on these issues, and we had a room about this full of educators from around the world. And one of the things that we talked about then and that this talk represents is really the challenge in the heightened environment of compliance, especially research compliance, and I know you all have been through a pretty rigorous process to align your policies and your practices, and those of us who, you know, labor over IRB proposals, and also those of us who deal with University Counsel's Office who are concerned about liability and those kinds of things. Those compliance issues can take up a lot of airtime, take up a lot of responsibility and attention. And our contention in the talk a couple of years ago is that those are important, but they are not enough. Compliance is only one part of what I call here the embedded ethical issues in the decisions that we make. And some of them are so embedded that we may not even think about them. And so my sort of siren call today is how do we help kind of uncover some of the embedded ethical issues that may reveal themselves in our decisions about who to study and how to study them and how we talk about what we found and then what we owe to the people that we studied. And like almost any ethics workshop, it will probably reveal more ambiguity and questions than answers, but the questions in and of themselves and the dialogue, I think, are important. So I'll start by talking about some of the examples that my colleagues and I have unearthed about embedded ethics. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about Tuskegee because it's one of the premier examples of why we are in the compliance environment that we're in. But then I'll also talk a little bit about ethics. And the great thing about Tuskegee is it gives me a chance to talk about moral courage, which is a prevailing interest of mine. Then I'm going to talk about dilemmas versus ethical or unethical behaviors and share with you a paradigm that I've borrowed from Rush Kidder's work at the Institute on Global Ethics. And through this, I'm going to show you clips, and we're going to talk about a couple of interventions that are currently being used, and we're going to use those as sort of springboards to talk about the research implications of those interventions. So there'll be opportunities for discussion and conversation and application. I know the folks that are being are watching remotely will perhaps not have someone there to converse with, but if you do, I hope you'll do that, and a chance to really think and apply what we're doing. We'll take a break about halfway through so folks can refresh, and if there's anything that I'm saying that isn't clear, by all means, please raise a hand and have me explain or elaborate. I would love to do that. And also, I will suggest that reasonable people will disagree. We will disagree about some things. We were talking with the doctoral students earlier. One of the examples that I use when I teach ethics came from when I was taking the licensure exam in social work many years ago, and there was a question on the exam that said, a client takes off her beads, her necklace, and throws it at you. What do you do? And one of the answers was keep the beads. One of the answers was throw the beads back. Pretty sure that wasn't right. And I actually don't remember what the other two choices were. You can always get it down to two, right? I can't remember what the other two choices were, but I remember thinking, it depends. What I would do depends. Is the child 5 or 55? I mean, is the client 5 or 55? Where are we working? What are we working on? How nice are the beads? It's an extra ethical question. And so, in fact, although ethics, the tradition of ethics is the decision about right and wrong, much of the work that we do involves contextual ethical decision making. It's ethical given or unethical given the context of things around. And given context, we'll agree or disagree about how we read some of the facts or the priorities or the proportionality of certain issues. And I think that the great thing about having a group and having a conversation such as the one we're having today is that we get to hear the other perspectives. We get to benchmark where our position is on a case with other people and to kind of weigh and consider those other perspectives. And that's great, because when we do research and we're part of research teams, those kinds of disputes will arise as well. So how do we get some experience in it? So I expect disagreement. We'll have different risk tolerances and different readings of the facts, and that doesn't mean anybody is practicing unethically. It means we're all striving to find an ethical soundness that works for us and the work that we're doing. So that's a bit about that. So let me just share some of the examples that have come up in, as we've begun this conversation with other folks. And as I'm doing this, I invite you to think of your own, and I will invite you to share them. So one ethical issue that has arisen for researchers is the researcher's own legitimacy. So a couple of examples. I have colleagues in Europe who are not Muslim or women, but who are doing research with Muslim women. Some of them are immigrants, refugees, some of them are students, and the question these researchers ask themselves in reflexivity is, who am I to be doing this research? Do I have legitimacy to be doing this? Do I have some other agenda in doing this research? Do I need to have similarity to the group that I'm studying in order to do the research? When we were talking about these cases in the Bolzano conference, a man who was in a wheelchair raised his hand, and he does disabilities research. And he said that question also goes in the other direction, the suspicion that we may have about someone over-identifying with the population. Does the fact that I myself am a disabled person raise questions to people about the objectivity of my research or my masking advocacy in the cloak of objectivity? So that's sort of who am I in relation to what I am studying and who I'm studying. And many of us come to our studies by a passion for something or an experience. And should that, how do we make sense of that for ourselves and for other people? I call this one making the snowball. So one of my colleagues from Italy was hired to do focus groups of family members who had disrupted adoptions to gather information about the services and the preparation they had to be adoptive families to help to understand, you know, the features of disruption. Perfectly appropriate, perfectly fine model. Well, when the families got together for the focus groups, they coalesced against the agency that had chosen them and placed the children with the families. And the researcher didn't try to incite them to become an angry collective, but the very fact of doing the focus group resulted in that, to the point where the focus group insisted on continuing to meet and became an activist group, kind of in opposition to the agency, and it put the researcher in a position of, for the agency, of what have you done to us? We didn't ask you to ruin our reputation in the process of trying to understand this problem better. So I call it the snowball because, you know, sometimes we end up making a snowball and then we end up running from it, and I think that's how my colleague felt. Another example, and I think that this happens quite often, this was actually from a colleague in Croatia, but it could be anywhere, does work with families of disabled children and does research with families of disabled children. And at the end of the data collection or the work that he was doing with the families, they said, well, aren't you going to help us? You're a social worker, aren't you? And he had not approached them in a utilitarian, I'm going to use you for my research. I mean, he had, in fact, probably the fact that he had approached them in a spirit of mutuality was part of why they thought that he would continue to work with them and help them get the services they had just told him they needed. Okay. So we know that research, fraudulent reporting of findings is not okay, is inappropriate. But what about errors of omission? And what about errors of omission when they're qualitative studies? So an example of a colleague in the U.S. shared, they were doing a qualitative study of health-seeking and health-using behaviors in the African-American community. And one of the members of the team, an African-American woman, didn't want some of the quotes to be used that were representing themes of the study because she felt that they were embarrassing and reflected negatively on the population, on the individuals. Okay, so the question of, and also then for the other researchers, why is it that that's the quote that you want to use to symbolize this theme or this perception? Okay. I know Cleveland has this. We have this in North Carolina. Go-to communities or go-to neighborhoods, which are laboratories for research. That's the nice way of putting it. Sometimes then the question is research communities, neighborhoods, schools that are studied to death, but are they ever better as a result of the work that we do? Is it exploitation or assistance? And what are the benefits to a group of the work that we do when we're embedded with them as researchers? A colleague of mine that was doing research with men post-incarceration, basically a study of supports or social networks and the ways that that could avoid or limit recidivism, was doing the study. And the men were, ultimately, they were wanted to be part of the study, but they said, we don't need a group. We need a place to live that isn't with our drug-using former, you know, running buddies. And then they would end up taking whatever place they could live in order to live, but putting themselves at higher risk. And, you know, these things happen. The issue for the researcher is, I took the money and designed the study knowing that I was giving people something that they hadn't asked for. But there wasn't any money to study giving housing to people. There was money to study giving them a group. Is that fair? Is that right? And am I setting them up by all of these other things being unstable in their lives? Oh, but they've got my group, and that's what I care most about. And what if they drop out of my group because they can't find stable housing? I mean, all of these intersecting issues when we're drawing one little piece of the pie. And then a number of colleagues have had the challenge. This one particularly came from a colleague in Europe who's doing research with Roma families. And the concern that the findings will lead to a backlash against a vulnerable population or reinforce stereotypes about that population, both in the sort of popular press, in the news, but also in, you know, service communities. Okay. So that's kind of a broad list. We're going to do a couple of things here. So throughout my talk, I'm going to have you have a conversation with your neighbor to kind of just do the reaction or reflection in a small group before we kind of talk about it as a large group. So the first thing I will ask you to do is just meet your neighbor. Even if you know them, say hi and talk about what you're going to do over the weekend or whatever. So just, and it could, your neighbor could be someone beside you or behind you, but just a couple or three of you say hi to each other and meet each other before you talk. Yes. So what I'd like you to do is to, with your folks whom you're now dear friends with, have a little conversation as you think about sort of my notion of the, if we think about ethics, not with the lens that makes human subjects and compliance in the foreground, but that makes all these other sort of more subtle issues in the foreground. If you just converse with your neighbor about any examples that came to your mind, either from your work or work that you've studied, that kind of evoke these other kinds of ethical dilemmas that on that journey. So a short conversation with your neighbor to try to generate some examples. It's always fun to see social workers talking with each other. All the empathy, warmth, genuineness, attending skills, all in one room. So who would be willing to share? Just let's try to get a few examples of things that might have come up in your small group to sort of fill out the list a little bit. Are there other examples folks would share? Yes, thanks. Oh, but wait for the microphone, please. The microphone is always a deterrent to people volunteering.
It is.
I hope
I can remember what I'm going to say. So we talked about the third one and the second from the bottom and how difficult it is in choosing research instruments to capture the phenomenon that you know in your heart occurs at the client level, but it may or may not turn out that way as the way the concept is designed. So you end up creating maybe a picture that isn't quite accurate, even though your measure says it's accurate.
So it was designed, developed, normed on some population that isn't necessarily the lived experience of the folks that you're studying? Is that part of it?
Well, that's part of it, the population, but just even the operationalization from the concept to the experience of the client doesn't really fit.
Great, great example. And these are not rights and wrongs. These are just the dilemmas that the situations create for us. Great. Other examples? So we heard folks talking, so I know, unless it was about the weekend plans. Are you going to, Victor?
So I do a lot of work in low-resource countries, and one of the dilemmas that we come up with around ethics is studying children who are in orphanages. Many times, parents place their kids in orphanages because it's a difference between getting one meal a day versus three meals a day. But then researchers want to come in and study the kids, the parental rights are still active, but they may be geographically very far. And in a low-resource country, they can't get to visit their kids even though they're still. So who do you go to get informed consent for children to participate in research?
Great example.
So it's a huge dilemma that's different almost in every country, how you try to figure that out.
Right. And also, what is it that when you know people's placements are as a result of desperation and financial exigency, how do we, you know, make sure that what we're studying is not frivolous, is going to have meaning for, if not those kids, kids in similar circumstances? Yeah, it's great. Someone else? Thank you.
I was contacted a few weeks ago by a lawyer office, you know. So they found one of my papers I wrote on female immigrant in Cleveland. Mm-hmm. So they wanted me to give them information. Because they wanted to write a support to the court. And I had a problem. How would that happen? Because normally I'm bound with the IRB issues. So I declined. Mm-hmm. I declined to work with them. I declined really to talk to them.
That was quite selfless, because they probably were going to pay you for your testimony or your assistance. Call them back. This is the other, you know, we can't be certain, it goes to a couple of these points, we can't be certain how our findings will be used and whether they will be used to advance the interests of people that we're studying or against the interest, and also how they're distorted. You collected it with a certain research hypothesis or question in mind, but the end user may use that in quite, especially if they're explicitly wanting to use it for an advocacy position, may use it in quite a different way. It's a great example. It's a great example. Yeah. Betsy, back in the... You know, every Wheel of Fortune needs a Vanna and a Pat, right? So
those letters, Betsy. So a colleague and I spent several grueling hours earlier this week looking through contact logs for a study in which individuals who are being released from jail were contacted 2 weeks after release for an interview, and then contacted 6 months later. And the research staff had to maintain ongoing contact with the folks in order to even get those interviews after release. And one of the things we were noticing was that routinely, you know, 6-7 phone calls were required to multiple numbers to reach this population, a brother, a sister, an aunt, an uncle, etc. And we were sort of thinking also about what you could build into your research that might help facilitate that ongoing contact. So would it be possible, for example, to get funding to provide a cell phone for these individuals upon release? But then that also raises a lot of ethical dilemmas as well, because you're then giving them an instrument that could possibly be used for ill as well as for the purposes of research. So it seems like there are some potential things that we can do in research that also might have double-edged sword qualities.
It's a great point. The other thing I was thinking about is envisioning myself going through those logs would be, there's got to be a better way to make a living. that sometimes the choices that we make are for our own interest, our own efficacy in terms of efficiency in publications, what population or topic has interest and traction these days, and which is there's no funding for, so they'll just have to go on study. I mean, there's so many, and then doing research on a population that society kind of marginalizes and that also is such a transigent and unstable lifestyle, that's important but also hard. Yeah, great. How about one more example, David? Oh, two more, excellent, great. You and then David, thank you.
I am Sonia Minnes, kind of working for the longitudinal study, looking at the prenatal cocaine exposure, and now that cohort become 18. So now some children kind of asking question about what is my status, whether was I exposed to cocaine or not. And it's really great question, and if you are the person, you'd like to know that answer.
Yes.
So in our research group, kind of talking about that, you know, what we should do if they ask, and also actually few children ask when they are 15 or 16. So, but some argument is it's also your that mother's information. And we consulted with lawyers from school, and what current our position is, it's not us to tell that information. There might be other ways that child can find out, but not this. So I have some two kind of issues with this thing, because one is even if you would like to tell that person, because that will be very important information, but you belong to organization who doesn't take that risk, any liability. And second one is what that information will do that child, you know, in terms of how that person as a young adult or to continue their life, and what kind of implication that person have.
It's a great, great example. And it's that on one hand, there may be feeling like I owe these kids something, having been part of this study all this time, and yet, you know, when you said you consulted lawyers, the thought in my head was, well, nothing good can come of that. you know, I mean, that's a perspective, that's a risk management perspective, and yet also you're thinking about what are the clinical implications. You know, our research doesn't want to create other harms, other challenges for these kids. And so many dimensions to that. It's a wonderful example. Thank you. I'm glad your team's wrestling with it, even though I'm sure it's painful. Great. David.
One of the issues we talked about was exploitation of communities. And most of the research that social workers do is community-based. And we finished the research. You know, we publish articles in journals, make presentations and conferences, but we don't routinely go back to the community and share the findings. Usually we're not funded, you know, to do that, but I think that's a real issue. I think if you're interviewing people in the community and you're working through organizations, there really is a responsibility to share those findings with them and not say, well, here's a copy of this article.
Right.
But to really discuss it with them.
Right, here's the URL you can get online and look it up, if you have a journal subscription. And then, you know, another related thing is funders who support dissemination, who will support you going to a conference to give the findings, but not, you know, looping it back to the community, perhaps with some other assistances that may be indicated by the findings. It's a great example. Yeah, Betsy, another person right there. Raise your hand so Betsy can see you there.
Just to add to David's point, and also talking about the population that Myung was talking about, we decided we wanted to give feedback to our children, our teens, and our families who were asking about that. And my partner and I talked a lot about how it took us several months, actually probably longer than that, to come up with the newsletter. With a summary of the information, and what right did we have to give our summarized, watered down version of their participation in the study? But we also provided references
links
so that they could read the actual things. But that was really very difficult task. But our team was committed. I can say we had a committed team that took several months and finally did it.
That's great. So talk, for if you will, about sort of what were the challenges that it took the several months? I mean, aside from volume of work and things like that.
Sure.
It was more than that.
Well, yeah, there's the volume of work, and then it was assumptions about, we know the average IQ, the average reading level of the mothers, of the children, writing it in an understandable way, writing it in a way that wasn't feeling hopeless about findings that had to do with things that we study, like executive function or language skills, and also talking about their environments, which are primarily impoverished in ways that sound all academic and heady
and but sterile and meaning and to them. Numerical, yet not their lived experience. Yeah,
right. Right. So we gave that out to every family.
Good for you.
No, it was hard.
Good for you. I'm reminded of, you know, the advice that we give to students who are learning documentation is imagine that your client is reading your case notes or is reading your assessment. And that's not a parallel for that I've experienced for how we should write up our findings. You know, I mean, we write it with a different cast because of the audience that we're writing it for. If we were writing it back for the folks we had studied, not, you know, just the level and all of that, but really what's the respect and what are the other dimensions of that? It's great. Great. Thank you. Super. So, fabulous. So let's talk a little bit about the Tuskegee syphilis experiments. The Tuskegee syphilis experiments, we teach it in every Research 101. Tuskegee syphilis experiments took place over 40 years, 4 decades. 13 refereed journal articles were written about the experiments. When we teach it today, at least when I teach it with my students, there's often a sense of, oh, Tuskegee, that was backwater thing, people, kind of underground, people didn't know about it. No, it was funded by the CDC and the Institute of Medicine. It was approved by the American Medical Association and the National Medical Association. It took place very visibly in that there were 13 journal articles written about it. We remember one of the aspects of the study, the fact that the sharecroppers with 300 black sharecroppers with syphilis had their penicillin medication withheld from them. But the study started before penicillin was a treatment for syphilis, and men were given lumbar punctures without medication, without anesthesia to test their bad blood. And there are fascinating books and articles about the sort of just the use of the language bad blood and how that was used to induct the men into the study, how the ways that it was construed and the resources given, the compensation given, were used to involve the men in it. There's a movie, Miss Rivers Boys, about the nurse Rivers, who's pictured in both of these pictures. That's her. And up there, about her role in the study. And, you know, you can't trust a cinematic version of anything, I don't think. But there have been books written about that as well, about her sort of her role and her increasing discomfort with it. But she was in a certainly an ethical dilemma between the health service leading the study and the men she was studying. The fellow down here in the corner I want to talk about for a minute is Peter Buxton. And Peter Buxton, in the 70s, was a venereal disease researcher, as we called it at the time, a VD researcher. He was a summer job. He signed on to do interviews with the subjects of the study. And almost immediately, he became concerned about the purpose and execution of the study, what it was about. And he began, at that point, to make a variety of efforts to try to get the study reviewed and shut down. I talk about him quite extensively when I teach about moral courage, because often when something troubles us ethically and we want to make a stand about it, it can be hard to know who to go to and what levers to pull. And sometimes you might say, well, I reported it to Child Protective Service, that's all I can do. Or I reported it to the supervisor, I've done what I can do. And Buxton just went above and beyond over a period of several years, during which he got his law degree, and I think that had been his plan all along. I don't think he just got a law degree to participate in this, but he tried all different forms of persuasion. He tried to say, this isn't how we treat people. And he tried a risk management perspective. This could look bad for your organization. This could bring this study down. He got treated in various ways that will be familiar to people of conscience. He was told, we'll look into it. And he was called before a meeting of physicians, representatives of the AMA and the NMA, and he was the only non-physician in the room and was told, we've studied this, we endorse the study and its approaches, and you don't know anything because you're not a doctor. Ultimately, it was Buxton who turned the information about the study over to Jean Heller from the Associated Press, and she's the journalist that broke the story that you see there in the New York Times, and the study was shut down within a week. Now, I curse Buxton whenever I have to do an IRB proposal, but he's, and part of the reason he's interesting is it's, you can only find a black and white picture of him. You know, some sort of well-known whistleblowers talk on whistleblower circuits. They do the, you know, they try to help the rest of us be better. Peter Buxton has removed himself from view. And yet, what a profound impact he has had, and partly because of his determination and also his willingness to abide with the process over a number of efforts until he finally reached success. One of the things that Buxton's being rebuffed through his process, one of the things that demonstrates is the authority gradient, which I'll just talk about for a second. It's the notion in the authority gradient, and it was discussed in a study by the Institute of Medicine looking at medication errors. And basically, they found two primary causes for medication errors. One, bad handwriting and bad structures, you know, bad medications that sound alike. So we solved that pretty easily with electronics, with automatic dispensing systems, with cross checks, with iPads that will tell you the difference between Benadryl and Benzedrine. Those, you know, that got solved. But the other part that didn't get solved has to do with the authority gradient. Basically, the authority gradient indicates that the greater the difference between a person who sees an unethical event and the person who did the unethical event, the less likely it is that anything will happen, right? And so what we see in certain healthcare settings as a result of this study is efforts to change the culture. If you see something, say something. If you're the person who, even if you're the person who just takes out the trays from the dinner service, if there's some, the reward structure is in saying something, not in, not in deference to authority. Because deference to authority is good, you know, I mean, but it's not always good. And sometimes people die if we don't, if we're too deferent. And so an important finding from that. Another thing I was talking about with the folks at lunch is this study of hand washing in, I don't mean to pick on health settings, but I will right now. Because they study themselves very well. A study of hand washing, and basically in this particular study, medical settings, they found people washed their hands half as much as they were supposed to. And we know that hand washing is really significant for the control of infection, et cetera, and so forth. So as the study looked at, well, what interventions shall we do to improve the compliance, the adherence to hand washing, you know, they considered the usual suspects, more signs, wash your hands, more convenient placement of doubling the number of dispensers or whatever. Went back and looked at the study. What they found was the most significant predictor of hand washing or not was whether the senior physician in the scene washed his or her hands. And, you know, I love that, you know, example because first of all, it's sort of the power of example. It's the power that we have as leaders in the teams that we're on to say or do the right thing and how that seeds ethical behavior. But also how we can waste resources and times on things that may be easier or, you know, I'll put up a sign that will to remind people. Well, it's not a matter of the sign if someone senior isn't doing it. So I, an apt example. So Peter Buxton, person of courage. And the other thing I like about Buxton's example is that he was acting on principle. He wasn't taking an ethical stand because he had a stake in it. He wasn't taking an ethical stand because he had a family member who was harmed. He took an ethical stand because it wasn't right. And it's really easy if you're just fighting the battle on behalf of somebody else to say, well, I've done all I can, and it's futile. So more power to Peter Buxton, wherever he is. So the Nuremberg trials and the Tuskegee syphilis experiments brought us, to some extent, to where we are today. Some good things and some pros and cons, some positives and negatives in regard to how we conduct our research. Certainly laws, a great result is now that there are laws that lead to accountability for researchers. The laws and those heinous cases also sanctioned social norms and helped to shape them so that it becomes part of the public discourse that some things aren't okay and that people have a right to know certain things if they're being studied. Certainly it brought public attention to people's rights, clarified compliance, which is really important. It's not just a concept. It has to go to standards and behaviors. And it creates minimum standards. I think the problem is, and you'll see this in some of the literature that I cite at the end of the workshop, is that we mistake sometimes the minimum standards for the ceiling instead of the basement. So, and the downsides, and Dubois' book is really quite excellent in this regard. It's discouraged research with certain populations. They're hard to reach, they're considered particularly vulnerable, and there may be important questions that we want to ask, but because of the difficulty of threading the needle of human subjects protections, we're challenged in doing it. And the downside of that is there are things that we don't know about populations who could really benefit from the study of their conditions. Another downside is that as with anything, when there's a scandal, the pendulum swings in a particular direction quite rapidly. And so what we have is a reactivity and perhaps a goal displacement of focusing on individual protections, not necessarily the protections of communities or families or other larger sized groups. And this kind of goes with the minimum standards. Compliance is necessary, but not sufficient. Rules, regulations are good, but they're not a substitute for ethics. The focus on compliance reduces research reflection. Say that three times fast. The kind of reflection that we're doing today about what is it that we're doing and why and how and what are those other elements, that's another challenge. And then it's created not just a risk management mentality, but a risk management industry, right? Compliant, I mean, there are people whose jobs it is to make sure we are in compliance and to help us to avoid liability and difficulty. And one of the interesting things, and this is talked about in the Dubois book, is suicide. Studying suicide, which is so important, I think there were statistics out, epidemiological statistics out this week about the high rate of suicide. And when you're studying prevention of suicide, suicide is an outcome. It's not an unforeseen event. And so, but how do you structure the research when something so undesirable is maybe part of what you're looking at. Dubois says it better than I do. But so compliance is good. It's a good thing. It's not the only thing, I guess, is what I'll leave that with. Beecher, in 1966, wrote an article in the New England Journal of Medicine and talks about clinical research and ethics. And I love this quote. The only true protection afforded research subjects comes from a well-trained, well-meaning investigator. Excuse me. I'll just drink out of my change agent cup. So. It's product placement, Cleve. And in fact, this gets to the notion of virtue ethics. In other words, at the ethics that we have of our character and how that infuses the approach. And without virtue ethics, compliance is really just papering over a variety of other ethical issues. So let me talk a little bit about sort of some of these concepts, and then I'm going to show you a little case that we can discuss. So. Ethical principles. There are a number of ethical principles. Beecham and Childress and other authors talk about them. But these principles really have us ask the question, what actions are right? What things should be done or should not be done? And there are different words for these. But the three particular ones that we want to continue our consider is the first is respect for persons. In other words, how do we respect people's humanity, their autonomy? How do we avoid harms? How do we respect others as human beings? And autonomy is such an interesting, it's an ever-present challenge in clinical work. And even though we have very vast and precise informed consent forms, whether people really internalize what the risks and benefits are on the consent form is obviously a matter of question. It's like a house closing document, you know. Do you read the title protection or do you just sign the thing at the bottom, right? There was a study a few years ago looking at physicians and men with prostate cancer. And the study found that the physicians, the surgeons, had minimized or skimmed over the risks of impotence and incontinence as a result of surgery for prostate cancer. And in their defense, the surgeons said, well, if we told the men about the risks, they wouldn't have the surgery. And the men said, that's right. And the doctor said, that's why we didn't, basically. I mean, this is the, and so, you know, there's, do we get consent, but do people truly have the autonomy to grant us consent or not? Beneficence, other side of it is non-maleficence, or the notion of how do we create goods from our research and how do we avoid harms? And creating the goods, I mean, there are goods in terms of advancing knowledge, but there may also be goods in calling attention to a problem that people may have. But there are also harms, physical harms, social harms, psychological harms, legal harms. And the other piece is that our roles obligate certain beneficent behavior. And so we have to look at not just how do I treat this other person, but how do I treat them as a social work professor? I mean, we're carrying all of those roles at the same time. And then justice, this whole question of equal access. Access to be studied, equal access to be studied, to benefit from the study, to say no to being studied, the equal distribution of risks and benefits. You know, I'll often say we have a community in North Carolina with a large immigrant population. And kind of faltering economy, a chicken plant that closed down, et cetera. And it's the go-to place when people want to study the Latino immigrant population in our area. And one of the questions I ask is, would we do this study in, you know, Chapel Hill? Would we go to the Chapel Hill High School and try to do this study, or Shaker Heights? Pick your, you know, affluent community or neighborhood. And then what are the, you know, and what are the people in my view, Siler City, getting out of it? So the issue of justice. And then rights, the notion of principles that are translated into the view of the subject, not the researcher. So it's putting ourselves in the subject's shoes and the rights that are being given to them. Virtue ethics, I referred to it earlier, these character traits to know what's right and to do what's right. And I love this quote, intellectual humility, which is, you know, it's not our stock in trade sometimes in academia. How do we cultivate that? And the recognition that our intentions matter, why we're doing a certain thing, not just how we're doing it. But then also procedural ethics. So there's a right way to do the right thing. And do we have sound, inclusive, sorry, there's a typo there, processes that assist our action, that thwart unethical impulses? It's sort of the sunshine is the best disinfectant. How transparent are we? How open are we about the processes that we're going through? And so I love that you, in your discussion of the longitudinal study, it's a group discussion. I love your willingness to share it here because it's part of that. These are the procedures. And what I like about it, is, what I appreciate about your example is, actually all your examples is, not everyone may agree with where you came down. It was kind of what I was talking about before about the it depends. You took a series of facts, you weighed them out, and came down, and this is our decision. And that's, you know, that's sound. And it's also able to, it's procedurally sound as well as sound in integrity. So I appreciate that. Let me check my, great. So let me, I'm going to, okay, let me talk about Kidder. Okay, right and wrong. So right ethics is the study of right and wrong, and certain things are wrong, exploiting people, stealing their money, et cetera. When those things happen, those are not ethical dilemmas. Those are just right and wrong. Dilemmas come, and there are other ways that people define it, but the definition that I like so much from Rush Kidder, from his work at the Institute on Global Ethics, is that we're talking about competing goods or competing rights. And Kidder was the founder of the Institute on Global Ethics, and they do work all over the world, all different kinds of industries, and you know, academia, sports, military, et cetera. He's done work with the CIA. All ethical dilemmas, in Kidder's perspective, can fall into at least one of these four categories. Okay, I love Kidder's paradigm. I used it in my Ethics of Practice with Miner's book. And I think it's helpful for us because when I have a dilemma, rather than it just sort of being an amorphous dilemma, kind of putting in a category, figuring out what it is, what's the precedent for it, is helpful. So let me share these competing goods with you, and then I'm going to ask you to generate some yourself. And I will try to use research examples in this. I may not always, and so you can be thinking about research examples if you want. I put justice versus mercy first because it's the one that I'm vexed by the most. It's the most troubling for me. I wrestle with it the most. And the notion, and any of you who enforce standards or policies or enrollment criteria, you will understand justice versus mercy. Because justice would say, there's a policy, you follow it. There's an eligibility criteria, you follow it. There's an enrollment guideline. Right. But then mercy, right? So, I mean, anybody that's ever worked with, you have to do the eligibility for a scholarship, and the person can't make over $20,000 a year. Well, they make $20,100 a year, but they have a disabled child and are caring for an ailing aunt, and, you know, it's good to be just, it's good to be merciful, and sometimes we can't be both. And the reason we have justice is so that, you know, a soft touch like Betsy and a hard, case like me don't evaluate people's cases capriciously, right? It's for consistency. And it's also so that a hard case like me is consistent whether I like somebody or loathe them, right? If it's $20,000 enrollment criteria, it's $20,000. Right. So let me just ask you this. How many of you, and we'll make sure the camera's on me, not on you, how many of you have ever gotten a warning when you should have gotten a speeding ticket? Okay, excellent. Are the rest of you bitter? Yeah. So those of you scofflaws, I used to get more warnings before I turned 50, not so much anymore. So those, of course, the answer would be just don't drive over the speed limit, but that's too easy. Those of you who got warnings, when the officer gave you the warning, did you say, oh no, I was speeding, and justice requires that you give me a ticket? Now, I know there's some do-gooders in the room here who might say that, but right, you say thank you to whatever your higher power is, and then you drive off really slowly, and then you speed up. I know what you do. Yeah. I mean, and this, we encounter this all the time. Plagiarism. Somebody cheats. Well, in my school, that's a referral to the honor court. And that could, you know, that could mean that someone doesn't graduate and they lose their whole semester. I mean, we're always, we all benefit from second chances, from teachable moments, from the exceptions and the context. But we also know people who persistently benefit, you know, for whom there is, never is a bottom line of accountability. And so, justice versus mercy. Truth versus loyalty, also a common one for social workers, for researchers, because we agree to keep things private. Truth versus loyalty. Loyalty is we've agreed to keep something private, and truth is we want to tell. That can be, there is an example of a physician who writes a column in our newsletter was telling about she talked about the weight of a secret, and she talked about a patient who had HIV who didn't want his family to know, because then they would know that he was gay, and he died of pneumonia at 30-something. And the family was appalled and bereft and perplexed. How does a 33-year-old die of pneumonia, you know? And obviously it wasn't her. She knew what her responsibility was. She knew both the chapter and the verse, and she owned that. And yet that didn't mean that there wasn't a dilemma of truth versus loyalty. The research that you're talking about it wasn't yours to tell about the, and if you did tell about the substance use, it's the mother. It reveals the mother's history. I mean, we see this a lot in genetics research about BRCA1 and 2 and the genes that in testing one family member may reveal health issues or non-relatedness or other things about other members of the family. And there's actually quite a robust literature about that. It's not my particular area of strength, but truth versus loyalty. You know, we invite people to tell us their secrets, and then we get to carry them around with us, and that's the challenge. Long-term versus short-term. The dilemma is, do I do what's best for the now or what's best for the later? And both are good, important. We give kids medication, and maybe that medication helps them be less hyperactive in class and attend and have attained school success and all of that. But what does it mean down the line? What's the long-term implication, right? Or we make a decision for the long term and miss. Meanwhile, so we give this group of ex-convicts groups about self-actualization and anger management and those kinds of things that may be very helpful in the long term, but not so much while they don't have a place to live. And then individual versus community or individual versus other is the classic conflict of interest. And sometimes we're the other. You know, is this in my interest versus the other's interest? So who are we studying, and whose interests are we upholding? Hopefully that makes sense to folks. So I'm going to let you then visit for another couple minutes with your neighbor, who you talked with earlier, and just see whether it's about research or about practice, if you can come up with any examples of dilemmas, ethical dilemmas, that kind of fit into Kidder's framework here. So let's see if we can generate a few more examples. So discuss. I'm always loath to disrupt a lively conversation, but so I can tell there are examples out there. Who is willing to share an example of a dilemma that might fit into some or all of these categories? Great, thanks.
So I was talking about how this is applicable to our direct practice class, and I was thinking about the type of ethical dilemmas that come up in class, and one of them that comes up each year is billing, and we have to give our clients a diagnosis in order for them to be able to get the services. We know that they may not really fall into this criteria, but we don't want to let them go because we know that they need these services. And so that's the justice versus mercy one.
Absolutely. It's also individual. I love that example in part because my dissertation research here at MSAS involved looking at social workers in private practice and the effects that insurance reimbursement had on their clinical decisions and the people's willingness to admit giving false diagnoses, more severe diagnoses than necessary. And one of the compelling parts of the research for me was the notes that people would write on their back in the day paper surveys. They actually came in the mail. Surprised we had any response rate. And some people were like, well, my client agreed to the diagnosis. Do you think the client understood that a depression diagnosis at 16 might mean that you don't get a military clearance or other kinds of security, that it's going to be a pre-existing condition? I mean, there are so many layered elements to that. And also, part of the reason we're getting reimbursement is for us, right? I mean, or our agencies. So there's also that individual versus other, where the other is our livelihoods. Great example. Great. Near and dear to my heart. Other folks, other examples that fit into this category. Troublemaker in the back.
I think we frequently see examples of justice versus mercy or individual versus the community in zero tolerance policies, particularly if we do school-based types of research, and also in mandatory sentencing. And the notion is there's a distributive justice principle, that justice is distributed equally across the population and there isn't discretion involved. So that takes priority sometimes over these other things. But you see these horrible dilemmas where you see cases where it really is obviously misapplied and wasn't intended to work that way. Kindergartners who get suspended from school where it actually happens.
Right. Also, zero pay or play kind of policies in schools. So, if this kid is caught doing a substance, then he can't be on the, you know, whatever, baseball team. Well, maybe the baseball team is the only reason he's coming to school. And if he's caught smoking cigarettes that's to me a clear justice versus mercy dilemma. Yeah, and part of the issue is the social environment that we're in may. It's easier to say justice than, I mean, mercy takes more time. I mean, I'm sorry, justice takes more time. Writing you the speeding ticket, going to court, seeing if you show up, reporting the kid for plagiarizing takes more time than just saying, don't do it again. You know, let this be a lesson to you, don't do it again. Yet, people like they take comfort in I was following the rule and the rule told me to report, or the rule told me three strikes, you're out. Yeah. Great. What else? Let's have another example. Thanks.
Since you you right here. In the truth versus loyalty space, I was thinking about how we negotiate that balance in our informed consent documents. When we recruit individuals to be in some studies, they want us to be loyal to them. And that means not revealing things we see. If we go into the home to do an interview, they want us to ignore everything else that we see.
Right, ignore the transactions that are taking place out the back doorway or the, right.
And so in the consent document, we'll say something like, if we see anything that places the child at risk, we will have to inform. But if we see other things that are unrelated, those are things we'll look the other way on.
Yeah. And that whole risk thing is, though, a big, you know, a big gray area. Right. Right. Because if the family's heating their home with the stove, they didn't invite you in to comment on how they're heating their home, and yet that's probably not the same. I mean, so as an example. Yeah. Great. Let's have one more. Thanks, Kathy.
So this is one in consultation with my field colleagues. We are talking about when you are merciful to students who don't quite come up to the standard over time, then you are not really doing them a lot of favors, nor are you protecting the community. So the role of gatekeeping versus student support, and just how you look at the interplay between justice and mercy and then the individual versus a community need comes up throughout education.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I just finished doing an article with, or manuscript with a colleague who's the former dean of students, who has a JD and also now an MSW, but she was dean of students at Carolina, and about accountability and our different ways of holding people accountable or screening for adequacy. And it could be, student judicial processes, gatekeeping, it could be licensing processes. But, you know, those are a lot of disconnected, you know, someone you may say, don't do this again and pass on may do it again. And or an employee that we let go who then ends up getting hired someplace else and doing the same thing there. I mean, we're just glad to be done with them. We don't want to report them to a licensing board, and yet, you know, these things go on. And also our sort of disagreements about what's a proportional response. When is something amenable to disciplinary supervision or to education? And then when is a situation where no amount of ethics CEUs is going to be sufficient to, teach virtue ethics, right? Yeah, it's great. So this is fabulous. So I'm going to tell you about an organization that's a very rich laboratory for us to think about ethics and research. But we're going to take our break first because I'm mindful of Maslow's hierarchy, right? So let's take 15 and stretch, and I'll see you back here in 15 minutes. Okay, so slides, for those of you who want to avoid taking notes, will be available on the Blackboard site and on the website. Great, super. One more, not necessarily apropos of this slide, but about the importance of conversation. Some of you might have seen that we have new legislation in North Carolina, HB2. Some people refer to it as Hate Bill 2. It's known as the bathroom law, but really the regulations on who can use which gendered bathroom are really the least of the issues in the bill. And the rich discussion has been about how do we as social workers, as social work students, as social work educators, carry out our disagreement with the bill? How do we, what's an ethical response to an unjust law or policy? And it's a challenge. So we had some students who tore down the bathroom signs indicating the gender of the bath, the gender designation of restrooms. And then and then people who take issue with that. I mean, there are a lot of kind of combined issues. And so one of the things that's coming up, and you can look for me at on the UNC website, you know, dueling websites about it. Rick Reamer, who's an ethics expert in social work, and I are going to host a webinar on sort of civil disobedience and laws, and how can we be ethical and do ethical and uphold our codes of ethics. And it will be the kind of thing where reasonable people will disagree. Some people will take a more conservative stance. Some people will take a more a stance toward more acts of civil disobedience. And I think Rick and I can help kind of give the shapes to those things. So, and it's one of those things where we're talking about variations within the ethical to try to deal with a challenge. And often, going back to this dilemmas, we're not talking about choosing to do right or wrong. We're choosing about which right thing do we do when, obviously, there are compelling arguments in both directions. So, all right. So, project prevention. I'm going to show you a couple of clips about project prevention and where we're going to talk about it.
I wonder where they are.
Highway 99 in California's Central Valley. Across the country in North Carolina, there's an organization that pays women not to have any more babies. We're about to meet someone out here who accepted that controversial offer.
Yes.
Where did you move from?
This is Joanne. She's 32 years old and a recovering drug addict. She recently gave birth to twins who tested positive for meth. Child Protective Services took them and her three other children away and put them in foster care.
As a mother, explain what that was like.
It's hard to sit there and to explain to your children, Mom, why did they take us? You know what I'm saying? And to have to tell them, look, they took you away because of my drug use.
A few months ago, Joanne says a California social worker told her about Project Prevention. The group targets drug addicts with a $300 cash incentive not to have children.
What we've seen is Project Prevention will go into certain communities and try to recruit candidates.
We have a nonprofit organization and we offer cash incentives to drug addicts and alcoholics to use long-term birth control.
Me personally, I thought it was a good idea. I'm not proud of the fact that my babies were born under the influence. And it's a mistake that I made, but I do see the point of view that this lady's trying to do. She's trying to keep babies from being born under the influence.
That lady is Barbara Harris, the founder of Project Prevention.
If they get the tubal ligation or a vasectomy, it's a one-time payment of $300. If they get the implanon or the IUD, it's payments every 6 months when they verify that the device is still in place.
I got the IUD. When you're on drugs, you aren't thinking about using condoms. You aren't thinking about taking a pill. You're just having sex out there using. And if she's going to give you $300 to either get an IUD that's in place for 10 years, maybe while you're getting that IUD for the 10 years, maybe you can get that chance to go out there, get sober, find recovery.
There's one critic, and this is a drug counselor who was in Hawaii, and he said the following.
It's better to give the message that says, here is recovery, and you can have a wonderful life and raise children of your own and be a great parent, than it is to say that there's no hope for you and take the sterilization.
Who's to say that if I didn't get this done, and if I was still out there using, that I wouldn't come out pregnant again? And if I was to come out pregnant again, who's to say I'm not going to do it over and over again? It's just a cycle. If I don't break it now, who's to say I'm not going to keep doing it?
It's been 1 month since Joanne took the deal. No more children, she says. She's been to drug rehab and undergone counseling. She hopes to get her 5 kids back in a few weeks and vows to remain drug-free. Dan Simon, CNN, Merced, California.
Okay. So, this is another, this is one of the, this is the stats page. So there isn't research on project prevention. We're going to become the ethically consultative research team for that organization, but this is what they have for stats as of April, and basically in terms of the number of patient 5,500 quote-unquote paid addicts and alcoholics, breakdown by race, breakdown by type of birth control, and you can see the most commonly used one is tubal ligation, not sort of a temporary intervention. And so I'll come back to this slide, but I'm going to go to the next slide and just ask. So, oops. So in your small group, I'm just going to have a short conversation, and then I'm going to ask for you to share with me as a whole. As you think about this organization, Project Prevention, what are the ethical issues that might arise in intervention research on project prevention? What ethical issues might arise in doing evaluative research on project prevention? And what about the implications of doing no research on project prevention, okay? So I'll leave these. I think I'll put back up their screen, say their slide from their website, but then I'll go to these questions. So discuss the questions in your groups. So what are your thoughts about the various implications of research with this organization? Yeah, great, in the back-ish.
One thing that came up in our discussion is what kind of verbiage I can imagine was in the document that they signed when they signed on for this. And they're already, if they are addicted, looking for money. They sign it. It's not an informed consent, as you were saying. And we really struggled with that, you know, preying on this population that's already targeted and exploited. That was something we really struggled with. And also implications down the line for someone who chose the tubal ligation. Let's say 5 years, 1 year, they're sober and they're excited to start a family. Well, they can't. They can't have any more kids. They made that decision while they were on drugs. Those are some of the ethical things that we were focusing on.
Absolutely. And in many ways, the informed consent for the service is less rigorous than the informed consent that you would need to have to study the service. Yeah, great. Other thoughts from... Give Betsy a second.
Oh, this distance.
She's
away.
Got her. This is the wellness part of our program. And Betsy.
I should have had my pedometer on today.
Betsy has her.
So we were talking about the ability from a research perspective to really systematically evaluate the interventions and the comparative effectiveness of the different interventions, and to really have a good study. We talked about the fact that you'd probably need to randomly assign people to those treatments, and the ethical issues involved in randomly assigning people to a more permanent solution versus a more temporary solution. So that was one of the things that we talked about.
Yeah. And then your control group in the community, your, yeah.
Oh, crumbs, I just lost my train of thought.
Control group.
No.
It's the effect, it's the microphone effect.
It's the microphone effect. It'll come back.
When it comes to you, holler it out and I'll repeat it, and that way you won't have the microphone's deleterious effect. Zoe.
So one of the things we talked about was the fact that we had some personal visceral reactions to this intervention, right? And so then how would you be able to design an objective research, put together an objective research design, because there's already some strong feelings about what you would hope the outcomes to be.
Right, right. And we're known by the company we keep, right? I mean, to some extent, I mean, people here do research in populations of which they're not a part, on interventions that we didn't design and own. But this really pushes that envelope, doesn't it? Yeah.
So the other thing we were talking about, too, is from a research perspective, what are the outcomes? The primary outcome from the intervention perspective, from the designer, is to have no more children who are born addicted to a substance. But as researchers, I think it would be our job, ethically, to also study other potential outcomes. So continued drug use, maybe getting children back from who have been taken away, or other sort of potentially negative outcomes of this intervention would be something that we should study from an ethical perspective. Maybe might not be of so much interest to the person who is designing the intervention.
Great. Excellent.
I remembered.
Yay.
So what if the intervention does not work and the woman becomes pregnant, and then how do the reporting issues play out in that as a researcher? You know, now you know that the person is using substances while pregnant. You might be subject to laws in the state regarding reporting.
And to the ire of Project Prevention, who wants their $300 back, I guess. I mean, and another deleterious outcome is what happens with the $300? How does that, I mean, are you inciting other social problems? Yeah.
I started thinking about it upstream.
Great.
Is the program itself an ethical program? And, you know, if you're a researcher, is it ethical to research something that's not ethical?
Yeah. So there's a social work educator on the board of Project Prevention, which my students have. Every fall there's a question, when they learn about Project Prevention, there's a question about, well, is it ethical to be on the board of this organization? And I've actually had conversation, or tried to have conversation with the person who's on the board. And so we talk about, you know, are sometimes people on the board to try to, are on governance groups to mitigate other harms, to avoid other harms, to make sure that, I don't know what the mitigations would be in this case, but yeah, there are a lot of larger system questions about that.
I mean, because the bottom line is, they may be using the money to support their habit.
Almost certainly. Yeah. She's coming. Hold that thought. I know. I know.
Just along that same line, I think it goes even further than that. Is it ethical to plan a program where you influence or coerce someone's right to bear a child?
Right.
I think it, on that level, is just, that to me, that's what what makes everything of all the, well, you ask all these questions where it stops. How can we, how can they ask that, them to do that even?
And is sort of my question back to you is our researching of this an endorsement? Does it feel like an endorsement of that program?
The opposite side, though, I don't try to speak loud enough and you can repeat it, but the opposite side of that is your last question. I mean, is it ethical to not do research on the project? I mean, by not doing research, you may allow the person who designed the intervention to claim that it is tremendously effective, and you can get some policymakers who buy into that, and if there isn't an objective research study, then, you know, how can people have the information about the effectiveness of the project? And can we all just take the stand that we're not going to do the research because it's unethical, it's an unethical project?
Right.
But if it's effective,
but still unethical, why do we need to know that it's effective?
Well, we have a lot of social policies that some people would consider to be unethical. I mean, we pay women and children to go to well visits, to get shots. I mean, there are incentives built into the healthcare system that we might find objectionable, perhaps not to the level of some of these things, but there are other things that we're doing that are policy-based that may not have a lot of effectiveness research.
We require parents to go to parenting classes when I don't know how well the data shows the efficacy of that. And sometimes that's a condition of service to attend the parenting class. And we don't say to the parents, this is an Eileen Gambrell example, and we don't say to the parents, these have been shown to be about 50% effective, but still I'm going to require you, I mean, along that line,
right?
Although a parenting class isn't going to affect one's fertility for the rest of their life.
I think so.
Yes, great.
It's similar in some ways to the APA's dilemma in advising the government on torture and then stating that torture was very successful in obtaining, you know, valuable information.
That's great.
And it goes to the earlier point about how do we have we have knowledge, and we may not be able to control how it's used, how people use the knowledge that we generate, and it can be used for nefarious purposes. A hand over here. I know there is. Hey, Kathy, give your hand up. Oh, wait. While Kathy's getting the microphone, so this goes to the, you know, what, so this last couple paragraphs are, I don't know how the basis of the calculation, but we calculated the number of pregnancies, abortions, stillborn. So there are claims being made about the effectiveness of the program in meeting some kind of, which, again, from a research perspective, raises all kinds of questions about how was that claim made, and but who is also listening to that claim in terms of supporting the organization. Kathy.
Well, I was triggered by Karen's thought about doing research on it. Similar to when abortion was first made legal, and there were many claims that women who would have abortions would have mental health problems, they would have higher rates of depression, they would have all kinds of issues. And it was only through objective research that followed women over time that said, no, those two things were not associated. So I think that there is, that makes me think that we should be researching these kinds of what are the other outcomes in order to just provide other pieces of information about it to make decisions. Because there'll be a lot of people who think this is a great idea.
Oh, they got $300 times 6,000 people from somebody, plus whatever it costs to run the outfit. So, yeah.
Well, I was wondering, what is it, the $300 that's the issue? Because here in Ohio, the Ohio Equity Institute has promoted LARCs as one of the long-acting reproductive control, as one of the principal strategies that they're pushing to decrease infant mortality and avoid low birth weight births.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not to pay women, it is to make it easier. If a woman chooses this, that she can get it the same day,
mm-hmm.
In a clinic instead of having to reschedule and go through a bunch of hoops.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if I were to ask to study that program, I probably would not have a concern, but they're not coercing women in a high-risk subgroup into that.
Okay.
So it's kind of the population, but also the payment, but also the overall.
So overlay. Some meaningful differences that affect it. And the,
I think it is the $300. Yeah, is that $300 used in order to induce people to do this, for to have the money for whatever purpose they might have it? It's a form of coercion. That's what we're reacting to. I know when my studies are reviewed and I have a payment that's given to people for compensation for participation.
That Target gift card.
Yeah, the Target gift card.
$10.
What the IRB tells me they look at is this the reason why the person is participating?
Mm-hmm.
When I used to recruit college students to participate, I would put up flyers around campus with a big dollar sign. That was effective yeah. for college students, and they'd come in even for $2 once they saw the dollar sign. Well, I was stopped by the IRB from doing that form of thing. It was the,
we get
so
people
I,
to
I've
come
been
to
educated.
Meetings for pizza,
I've,
Cleve.
I have
so.
Changed over time. But I think, you know, this is an example where, I mean, if it would be a different study to follow women who had voluntarily chosen, after being given information, to choose one of these forms of birth control.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is a study looking at individuals who have been potentially coerced or induced to follow this.
Well, and also, what's the women's capacity since they're using substances? Did you can talk. Okay.
The other comment that I would like to add to that is, why is for this population, a person's fertility valued at only $300. How much would a person's fertility be valued in a court if this were the result of a malpractice suit or a failure to inform prior to a medical procedure or the adverse effect of a drug? The value of that individual's fertility would be far greater, perhaps into the millions.
That's great, great point.
Because they'll do it for $300.
Exactly.
I understand. Right, yeah. The very fact of offering somebody $300 is devaluing them to such a great extent that the morality of the program could be questioned on that basis alone.
Right.
I was just going to say, I agree with you, but I also disagree with you, because I think it has to do with the permanent nature of some of these. If they were offering the implantation where it could be removed at whatever point and it's temporary, then I think this would be more supported. But I think because of the permanent nature of some of these procedures that they're doing, that's more of the issue I see.
Yeah, and the fact that that's the most common procedure is part of the challenge. Is there a hand? Great.
My question has to do along the same lines, but with informed consent, and has this organization been sued by someone? Because you're talking about women who are impaired in making a decision because of their substance abuse, which is how different is that from mental health or developmental disabilities, where these issues have been looked at? And you're right about the long-term nature of some of the options. So I just wonder if it's faced legal consequences.
Not to my knowledge. And my review of the clips in terms of, I mean, I could have just killed the 3 hours. We could have watched clips about this and run out. My review of the clips on it, there are some from, I would say, disaffected clients or of the organization, but I don't see anything that indicates they've been sued. And certainly there are, you can look this up, and there are, I think there's probably an Oprah episode, and you know, and there are certainly ethicists weighing in about, I mean, raising the very kinds of issues that you do. And one of the things that's it's a visceral case. That's part of why it's good to have after lunch and after, you know, when we've got to bring people through to the end of the workshop. But also, it's a case where the conditions under which the intervention operates are probably less restrictive than the conditions we would have in evaluating it. And so that, and then, and also, the thing that strikes me is, you know, I wouldn't want to evaluate it, but then what's that? Is that my interests over the organization, or is it my honest appraisal that I couldn't be a fair broker to it? And, I mean, there are all kinds of ethical dimensions in it, in addition to the very clear informed consent and coercion and other kinds of issues. Okay, other comments or questions? All right. So let's talk a little bit about sort of, you can go ahead, it's okay.
No, I think also one kind of uneasiness about this project is we discuss about kind of gender issue.
Yeah.
It's all on women. You know, but
well, talking about 146 vasectomies.
It's talking about the baby, and then you really talking about the woman, and there's nothing related to other part of the incident. So it's just whole thing is there's a very strong kind of woman body control,
yeah.
And that idea, and then you can control that reproductive ability and. I think that is really bothering us.
Right. Well, and I mean, the other piece is some of the language on different pages of the website, the little Facebook page, and that it used to be called CRAC, and I can't remember what it stood for, but I mean, it was an acronym. Control Reproductive Act, I can't remember what, but there are also things there that are sort of also part of that. Sort of objectifying the and it, in privileging and caring about the children, it diminishes then the other people involved in the equation, I guess. Yeah. Okay. So ethical problems. We can think about them into. In three categories. One is sort of volitional. In other words, I know what's right, but will I do it? It's this, my Grammy used to say to me, you know better than you do. I won't tell you what I was doing then, but it's, and this can happen, you know, this is sort of the moral courage aspect, the Peter Buxton being asked to do certain, get certain data from the men in the Tuskegee study. Cognitive problems, so uncertainty about what the right thing is to do. So, and, you know, I talked under Kidder about competing goods or competing rights, but sometimes we're dealing with competing bads. There are, there seems to be no good way out or no satisfactory win in a dilemma. And then there are social elements, too, and that this sometimes we see in teams or we see in our partnerships with community partners. I could envision it were we to partner with this organization, disagreeing about what is right. And sometimes even if we have certainty about what is right and the willingness, so even if we have the other two things, there may be disagreement because the stakeholders are viewing it from different perspectives, different areas of responsibility or different belief systems. This, I think, is a helpful, so kind of breaking out, going, playing off the questions that you all raised, or the comments you raised about the project prevention, trying to elucidate some of the ethical problems in partnerships, some of the ways that embedded ethics can emerge in our partnerships. And this sort of goes to community research partnerships, but it doesn't have to. One is, who decides the research agenda and the questions? And how much of that, and, you know, the process of funded research, sometimes those elements are quite well fixed before the partnering group gets involved to any kind of significant level. So who decides those? How much mutuality is embedded in that? What's the goal of the work? Is it solving the problem or understanding the problem? And sometimes this is the disconnect with community partners, the one where the families said, well, your social workers aren't, why are you leaving us now? Now that you know about our problems. So being clear about that. Who owns the data? And not just who has the right to publish the data, but who has the right to delve into it and to the example of the challenge in sharing it with the community partners is a really fabulous one. How do we as researchers of integrity resist the pressures of time and the pressures of money? We can't be dilettantes and just research, well, we can, but deans like us to get funded research, and research deans like us to get funded research. And so sometimes we follow the money instead of the research question. And the pressure of time. And one of the challenges, I think, in community partnerships is really, especially for new researchers, is, and plays into the exploitation issue, is to build trusting relationships in communities, and especially with groups that have trust issues or have had histories of exploitation. I'm thinking of your work, Kathy. And you have to really show caring intent, and you have to put in the time, the seat time, the being with time. That's a lot of upfront work without necessarily manuscripts and things to show for it, but it's, we try to tell people it pays off in the long run, but more and more I think that can be hard for people to do. The other piece is, who, on the other side, who speaks for the community? Who speaks for the population that we're working with? Sometimes in communities, the people that are in the positions of power or indigenous leaders, they have their own agendas, and that's fine, but that they still may not represent the needs of the people in the neighborhood or the needs of the residents of the institution. Whom will the knowledge help? And will the knowledge help the people who are being studied? And I kind of raised that question earlier, and we know when we ask people to take experimental drugs that the drug that's being tested is not going to help them in many cases. So there's a vast research about people participating in research for altruistic reasons, but I think it's quite common in our work that the people being studied are not the ones who are going to benefit except for by the expanse of knowledge. And then this question, should the community be able to approve research findings before they're submitted for publication? And then this gets to the, how are things construed? What are they, who is the population? Who represents the population? All of the questions that you all mentioned earlier. Sort of questions or reactions in response to these? Okay. So, Dubois talks about SFNO, and so far no objections isn't, it's just a mnemonic to remember SFNO. So this approach to thinking about the ethical issues and to opening up the conversation in our research teams, Dubois suggests thinking about stakeholders, facts, norms, and options, and so SFNO. And so when the stakeholders, so part of the consideration is in our conversations, who has a stake in the decision and who will be significantly affected by the decision made? So two, you know, different, multiple stakeholders. And the issue then is when parties have multiple legitimate claims, how do you reconcile those when one group, thinking of a colleague doing research in the HPV virus, and her research is in media, and how does media get people to, parents to give their kids the HPV vaccine for the against the virus? And I mean, it leads to all kinds of questions about parents' rights and what public health officials want, what teenagers want, and actually the vaccine is usually best given before teenagerdom, so parents' rights versus child's rights, assent versus consent. There are a lot of thorny issues about that. And then second issue is facts. What factual issues might generate disagreement? What facts are relevant to the solution? And, you know, one of the comments from medical research is the problem of probabilities, the probability that this child will end up with an intellectual disability or a lifelong neurological problems, or the probability that this medication will not cause any difficulties, or that this intervention will mean, this parenting class will mean that this parent can now have her children back. I mean, there are all kinds of important facts, and I guess part of the issue is how we draw the lens on certain facts in terms of making our decisions. Norms, so what are the ethical principles, norms, values, what's at stake, what are relevant, which are in conflict or generate disagreement? Are there bottom lines? Are there things that we just would not abide, that we would not find acceptable? And I think if you think back to the project prevention, there are probably some bottom lines that people would not abide. And then options. What options or policies should we deserve consideration? And if the ethical ideal isn't possible, what are least harmful substitutes for the ideal? What compromise solutions? And this is where brainstorming and consultation come in handy. But they take time, and they take reflection, and they take intellectual humility. Changing populations. Maybe we don't do this study with people who are actively using drugs because their capacity to consent is in error. Maybe we don't offer $300. I mean, what are the variations? One of the other pieces about that study, and I don't know how it works, but so for the women that take the long-acting, the LARCs, the long-acting contraceptives, they said when they provide evidence that the device is still in place, or the, so is that the physician or the medical professional reporting that to the, I'm just curious how that process happens and what's there, what's, anyway, I have more questions than answers. Or is it, does a change in procedures make a difference in how we do this study? Sort of an action decision framework, and I'm going to we're going to look at another intervention and come back to this framework. So let me, it makes more sense in light, I think, of the case, but let me raise it here. So the questions here, when we're trying to decide, okay, what action should we take? What options do we have? These five considerations, they don't spell anything like SFNO, but, or maybe they do, NEPLEP. First is necessity. In other words, is it necessary to infringe on values or norms or principles in order to achieve the intended goal? Or have we just not thought creatively or widely enough about what we can do? So can we do this without violating a value? Effectiveness, if it works, will the action be effective in achieving the desired goal? And we can apply this back to the project prevention example as well. Yes, that intervention, we think it's effective, but I don't know that there's any follow-up statistics about whether other pregnancies have resulted. Proportionality, is the desired goal important enough to justify overriding another principle or value? And that's what I heard you saying about this case, that yes, it's a desirable goal not to have children who are born with addictions, but the proportionality of what you're doing to achieve that goal sounded unsatisfactory based on your conversation. Least infringement, again, is the policy or action designed to minimize the infringement of the principle or value? In other words, the coercion in this, the unreversibility of the procedures would violate this least infringement. And then the proper process, and this goes to procedural ethics, what I've talked about earlier. Has the decision been made with transparency, community input, proper approvals? And one of the things I look at is the board of directors of that organization. That's how I identified our social work. There are two social workers on there, one of whom is a social work educator and researcher. But there are other people from faith communities, health, so what are their roles in this kind of endorsement? Okay. So let me, I'm going to show another intervention, and then I'll flip back to the other slide and we can have some conversation about this treatment.
The parents of a 9-year-old girl say they didn't want her to develop physically into a young woman, and they have a very good reason, they say, for that. Ashley severely damaged brain, a condition that developed shortly after her birth. Now, her parents say she can't walk, talk, sit up, or roll over. So 2 years ago, they approached doctors at Children's Hospital in Seattle. Remember, they're the ones who have to take care of her. And the parents told them, the doctors, that allowing her to develop breasts, have monthly cycles, and grow any taller than she is would only cause her serious discomfort and make it real difficult for her parents to be able to then take care of her. The ethics committee went ahead and agreed with the parents. Ashley had a hysterectomy, her breast buds were removed, and she began hormone treatments to literally stunt her growth.
In this case, being short was a benefit for the child, because other parents would make decisions to make their children taller, because that may be a benefit to the child. And so I think what all these cases have in common is an intention to help the child.
The first question, obviously, that comes to mind is something like this ethical? Should it be done? For some answers, in Seattle, bioethicists and Dr. Benjamin Bluford, who also saw that being some reacted to it, and in Albany, New York, Dr. Glenn McGee, bioethicist from Albany Medical College. Dr. McGee, let's begin with you. Is this something that you can look at and say it was necessary, it's okay to do it?
Well, I think first you have to walk a mile in the shoes of this family. They've done a lot for us in writing a 9,000-word blog entry, so we know a lot about what they thought, and I think anyone would have to feel compassion for the choices that they've made.
All right, give us the headline.
I don't know about the headline, but I can tell you that when the decision was made at 6 years of age that she should have a hysterectomy, that her booger ovary should be removed, that her breast bud should be removed, I think the family had started down a dangerous slope, and it's a slope that does not bode well for lots of children with lots of conditions around the world.
So you think this could set a precedent that it's something that should not be done?
I think it absolutely sets a precedent. And unfortunately, one of the things that's being trumpeted about this case is that an ethics committee agreed with it or even promoted the idea, which I think is probably an exaggeration. But, you know, it's a question of balancing.
Let's go to Dr. Benjamin Wilfolk. He says, Dr. McGee says, this is a territory that we should not be stepping into. You say why?
Well, I think it's very difficult for us to make judgments about a case that we speak from a distance. And in fact, the physicians and the ethics committee and the parents spent many months before making a decision. I think it's very difficult to generalize what they did to other families ought to do.
Do you think that this is something that should be considered at any time for children in cases like this?
I think it depends on the circumstances. In this particular case, maximizing her adult height did not offer her any particular benefit, and there might have been particular advantages for her to be otherwise shorter than she might have been.
Dr. McGee, let me come back to you. But the parents are saying, if she gets too large, we won't be able to move her. We won't be able to carry her. We won't be able to give her the care that is necessary. It would be impossible for us to be able to take care of her in the manner in which we're taking care of her now. That's a big part of their reason. Can you understand that?
I can understand it. I can sympathize with it. I look around me and I see lots of people about whom the same sort of thing could be said. It's clear that there's a difference between maximizing height or giving growth hormone, as my friend talked about earlier in the tape segment that led up to this, and doing what's going on here. Here we're talking about not so much whether or not it's in the interest of Ashley to grow up, as whether or not in the long run, what's being done is actually in her interest or just in the interest of the parents. And what we're trying to do here is make it easier to care for people with disabilities. How far will we go? I don't know how we'll go this far.
That's a great point. Let's take it over to Dr. Wilson. Dr. Wilson, what about we're doing things here because it really would make it easier for the parents? And the parents seem to be loving parents and really want to take care of their child. But what about the child's needs? Even though she's not able to articulate it, should they somehow be taken into account?
Absolutely. I think in this case, herpes and her parents' genes are completely convergent. So how do we know that if we can't actually interview her or talk to her or find out what she wants? Because her parents are able to pick her up and give her a hug, which would be a lot harder for them to do if she's much bigger. That strikes me as being an incredibly fundamental need. They don't even talk to a person to appreciate the value of that. Tough call. Well, I'll tell you, Dr. Benjamin Wilson, Dr. Leslie McGee, and thank you both for this conversation. Monday, Paul's on.
Oh, we don't care about Paul's on.
Compassion or convenience? Paul's on.
Oops. Okay. So, we're going to talk about the research. We're going to talk about the research implications of the case, but let's start by talking about the sort of the your reactions to the case, and maybe sort of think about it from an ethics perspective. And other people may, this got a lot of attention a few years ago when it first came out, so folks may have learned more about, you may have other background information to share. Thoughts, reactions? We have dueling bioethicists, so. Great, thanks, go ahead.
I think this one is so hard to talk about, and my reaction is pretty visceral. Mm-hmm. My main reaction makes me think that in our society, parents resort to something so drastic because we don't have good alternatives to take care of dependent individuals, no matter what size, what age, what condition. And I guess this issue, it doesn't even begin to address, you know, speak to that. So.
But absolutely, what is, what, and I, one of the elements that I think about when I think about the case is who, the doctors offered this as a response to the family, and had any other family come and with the same problems, what would they have been offered? And I mean, this is a white, middle class, well-to-do family. What if it was a single parent or parent of color? I mean, you know, the how their failure to be, their difficulty caring for her gets construed, I think is part of the conversation too. Yeah. Great. Other thoughts, reactions? So, I'll share some of the reactions to the case that are, a couple of things. One is, and they go to some of these points. I mean, one of the questions is, this is visceral. One of the considerations is, was this necessary to manage her? What were all of the things that were done necessary to manage her? It's a classic, also short-term, long-term dilemma. It gets to issues of personhood. In the slide, there's a report analyzing the case, an investigative report by the state of Washington, and there were failings in the case, even though it was approved by the bioethics committee, even though the bioethics committee wrote a published manuscript on it. So, and the surgeons have written about it, and the family blogs about it. A couple of procedural errors. One is that in the state of Washington, if you're going to sterilize somebody under the age of 18, you have to have a court order. The family's lawyers said, well, they weren't going to get a court order because they weren't sterilizing her to keep her from getting pregnant. They were sterilizing her to keep her from growing. And the law doesn't care why you're doing it. The law says you have to do this.
The other was that there was no one in the decision, bless you, to advocate for Ashley's rights. There was no guardian ad litem. There was no person to speak for her interests. Now, the question came up in the video about, was this just in the parents' interests or Ashley's interests? And one of the guys said they were in perfect intersection. And Peter Singer, who's an ethicist, said, you know, to the extent that they're going to care for her for the rest of their life, her interests are their interests. But we all know many parents whose children's interests are not totally concurrent with the parents. Another challenge that I have in the case is that the parents refer to her in an affectionate term as their pillow angel. And you see some references online to pillow angel intervention, or the parents will write in the blog, the Joneses have a pillow angel. And it could just be my sensitivities, but it's not Ashley, a 6-year-old or 12-year-old or however old she is now, but that objectification, I think, obscures some of the meaning of what was done, in the same way that saying the black sharecroppers were being tested for bad blood obscures what was done.
There were processes, but the processes weren't entirely appropriate. No one was brought up on charges with their licensure boards about it. But underlying this whole case is the history of eugenics in our country, and which 30 states up until the 1970s in my state. As a matter of fact, there was a woman, I've had a woman who attends my trainings who, because of her epilepsy, was sterilized as a child. The disability rights community that would say, who are you to decide about the quality of my life and what it means or doesn't mean to have these things. And so, I mean, how do those perspectives get brought in to our conversations? And I use these two cases in training. The theme of sterilization has no particular meaning except for two quite distinct approaches. And so what I want us to do in our conversation, in your conversations with your small groups, sort of, I'm giving you, you're now a research team because you've worked together so beautifully for the last 2.5 hours. And this is where we're at. The success and visibility of the Ashley treatment, as it's called, has led other families around the world to inquire about it and to actually some to receive it as an option for their children. A funder concerned about attachment and caregiver burden has put forward an RFP for researchers to study the Ashley treatment in the 7 known cases worldwide. So you've got an intervention research group. You're meeting to discuss responding to the RFP. Some team members are enthusiastic about the research. Others are highly disturbed. And so using the frameworks that we've discussed, and I'll put them up there, the bottom line is identify the embedded ethical issues and use the SFNO, and I'll put that back up, model to structure your conversation and decision. Okay, so research team, there's some money out there to study the treatment. It's not simply a question of would you do it, but what would be the elements that you would want to build in to do it with integrity? Okay? All right, let's discuss. Okay, so there's a social problem. There's parents of disabled children, disabled adults, who want to maintain them at home, are challenged by the lack of mobility, and the word that Ashley's parents use, pliability, of their kids. And so one of the options on the table is the Ashley treatment. What are some of your thoughts about the stakeholders who, if we're thinking about Who would we go to elicit perspectives about studying that problem and that in relation to this particular intervention? Among the other cases are males as well. I don't know exactly what the intervention is to. The intervention across is called growth attenuation across the board. And if I can be crass about it, in one of the ethical debates, somebody said, "Well, why don't you just cut off her legs?" Yes, yeah, so when you say that, you think it's not such a pretty, you know. And then the doctors responded, well, that actually has more negative side effects and more medical risks than the surgery and the intervention that we did do with her. So, and then you think the fact that we're talking about this is kind of a horrific or sobering at the very least kind of thing. So. At least one, I think, involves a male. You want to say more about that?
I think the stakeholders that haven't been represented in this case are those that come from the disability community, mm-hmm. whether they're other parents, other people with disabilities. These parents are not going to live forever. And so who is going to be taking care of this individual long term if she surpasses her parents? So I think that community has a lot to offer. And I didn't hear anything about their involvement, whether it was on the committee that looked at this decision, any other parents or professionals in that field that could speak to other options that would be available. It was just grossly neglected in my mind.
That's a great point. And also actually quite a bit of animus in the disability community from parents who feel we go to extraordinary lengths to do these services for our children. And so, yeah, great. So definitely that's an important stakeholder. Others? Yeah, great.
Just because I also enjoy playing the devil's advocate a little bit with our group here. So one of the things we talked about was a stakeholder that I haven't heard talked about would be the insurance industry. And whether or not the insurance industry paid for this or even would consider paying for it. But they certainly have a vested interest in the potential outcome of any research with this. But one issue we also talked about, if I could move just to something else,
sure.
was the facts issue, mm-hmm. that would it change our opinions and our level of with this procedure?
That's the technical term.
Yes. Our level of discomfort, okay.
Yes. Right.
And judgment. If there were medical facts presented that say that the people who had this genetic condition, 80 or 90% of them went on to develop ovarian cancer if they were allowed to mature, or that they all had the BRCA2 gene and would develop breast cancer, would we think differently? I think we might think differently and have different opinions about this as a possible intervention if there were other facts in the case.
Mm-hmm. So two great points. And one is, and to speak to that, Ashley's parents said that that breast cancer, they didn't say that the BRCA gene, but they did say breast cancer runs in their family. So that was part of the case for the removal of the breast buds, and that being in a sling or harness in either in her wheelchair or whatever would be more comfortable if she didn't have breasts. So those were two of, I'm just in response to yours. And remind me of your devil's advocate point.
Just the insurance.
Insurance, yes. And insurance did pay for the procedure. Pardon?
I said death runs in my family.
Death runs in your family. We could look for some ways to avoid that. Yes, great.
I'm just going to reiterate something that was brought up by you. This idea, what are the other alternatives? To me, this is a decision that was made based on a lack of resources, because an obvious alternative option would have been to have proper in-home care as needed for as long as she needed it. But since that doesn't exist in our world, you know, people resort to option like this.
Well, ironically, it's quite a well-to-do family, so there are a lot of families with many fewer resources who, even if they presented, wouldn't be given this as an option. But it does raise this larger question about, insurance will pay for this, but it won't pay for these assistive devices, or it won't pay for in-home care, et cetera.
Along that same line, I keep thinking about the unintended consequences, or even people know removing the source of estrogen can hasten her death, and how long she'll live, and what right do people have, and where do we draw those lines about that issue?
Right, right. And there is conversation about that among the doctors in their study too, but I think all male. I'm just back to Kathy's gender point. Not trying to incite a victor.
So it seems like one of the group of stakeholders, which weren't mentioned, were the extended family. Mm-hmm. And they would know the situation much better than any group of professionals who see them in a very time-limited way. So where were the grandparents and aunts and uncles
siblings.
And siblings, and how were they involved in making this decision? It seems to me that this is such a big decision that it should include a whole family group mm-hmm. that would get around and talking about this.
And then how do we balance our confidentiality and privacy protections to get the input of stakeholders, and also especially given the long-term care responsibilities that siblings and other extended family may bear? I mean, that's an important element. Yeah, great. All right. So we went into facts a little bit, but what are some of the facts that you would want, what's the data that you would want, or facts that you would want to have considered in, we talked about payment sources and resources of the family. What other facts would folks want to, the estrogen question, what other facts would people want to take into account? Yeah, what are the risks of the surgery? Yeah, yeah.
And what's the progression of the diagnosis that this young girl has
right.
Long term?
Right. When we talk about short and long term consequences, there are a lot of and some of that's playing the probabilities, but some of it's also what do we know about all of the various factors about her current condition, her current living environment, and her future living environment. Yeah. What do we know about what other families in similar circumstances do to maintain, and what do we know about their satisfaction in doing that? And what do we, I would say, part of, I don't know if it's a fact, but what is it that, what might be the family repercussions, it kind of goes to Victor's point, of this decision for the parents and the family members going forward? Are there trade-offs for the ability to manipulate her and have her active? So norms, what are some baselines, some norms that we would want to say these are really important if we're talking about ways to help families maintain their kids and young adults at home? What are some of the norms we would want to assure that our intervention maintains?
Do no harm.
Do no harm, right. So, and the study of this case has talked about, and we see it with genetic, with preventive mastectomies, and when people have the BRCA gene, are you intervening to deal with an abnormality, or are you intervening to stop a natural progression of, in this case, growth? And so, yes, what harms are created. Yeah. What else? I saw a hand down here. Yeah, Zoe.
I was just saying that everyone has rights in this.
Yes.
And so that the youngster has to have their rights protected as well as everybody else.
Right.
Right. Great.
I may have missed this, but I wondered about self-determination because I didn't know about her cognitive abilities.
Right. Her cognitive abilities are arrested at around the three-month level. Three-month, six-month level. Yes. But the whole question of autonomy and self-determination and how do we interpret that, who represents the rights of someone who can't articulate those wishes, is really important. Yeah. Great. Right here, Bits.
I can't get away from just the precedent setting of this nature. So whether or not it was ethical for her and that decision made for her, this then sets a precedent that's now affected seven others. Mm-hmm. And what that then means, and also what does that mean for people who would seek out this treatment but aren't receiving it for what reason? So if it's the financial, the insurance, and just the accessibility then. So aside from just ethical, the individual ethical issue, but the precedent setting.
Yes, absolutely. Because you open Pandora's box, and then and back to my eugenics point about then how, where do, you know, what other conditions and what other long and short-term considerations exist. Yeah. And then I think the other issue is, well, go ahead. Sorry.
I guess my question also was, who evaluated the child mm-hmm. in terms of their physical and mental disabilities, and that whole definition of quality of life, it makes a difference how and who is doing the evaluating. So, and how long ago and so forth.
That's great. And how much do they know about her, irrespective of that particular moment of evaluation? That's a great point. And then the options. What are other options that are procedurally sound, that are sound for how do we change, we're talking about issues like reimbursement and policies and assistance, and how do we help support families in these very difficult situations? Because, you know, the people who vilify the parents, you know, aren't dealing with this on a day-to-day basis in terms of the entirety of her physical and emotional care. And so what are the other options? And then the larger question, which one of you asked almost from the beginning, is we end up looking at it like this when there are all these things that we take as givens that structure then the choices that we make or don't make, or the interventions that we study or don't study. Okay. You've worked hard. I appreciate this. I'll just leave you. There are a few resources that I've referred to today, and also a link to some resources on decision making and ethics, the EMHR net resource. And I just want to double back again with my appreciation for the work that you do, for the wisdom that you brought to the session, for the chance to come talk about these things, and hopefully a beginning of a conversation among you and maybe with me and you that extends beyond today. So thank you so much.
Kim, so there is no doubt that you are our graduate. You have yet another product placement. Thank you for a wonderful conclusion to all of our colloquia. And you can come back again.
Okay, good.
And you can continue to be fabulous. And I think Cleve wants to say a few words, too.
Okay, thank you.
Well, Kim, it's really, really been a pleasure. It's been a challenging talk. I don't feel I'm going to have an easy Friday night coming home with these thoughts, but really this is what is important about this topic. It's not supposed to be easy, and you have challenged us today, and you've given us some guidance, some wisdom, but you've also raised a lot of questions for us, and that's what we need to have as we engage in our research, but also as we engage in our personal lives. So personally, I appreciate it, and on behalf of the school, I want to thank you very, very
much. Thanks so much. I appreciate it.
Okay, thank you.